He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
In the previous tutorial, we began learning about the most important class of minerals, the silicates, and we examined three of the silicate subclasses, those being orthosilicates, disilicates, and cyclosilicates. There are three more subclasses to go over, so let's talk about these now. The next group of silicates, called chain silicates or inosilicates, are divided into two subgroups, pyroxenes, which have single chains of silica tetrahedra, and amphiboles, which have double chains. Pyroxenes are composed of silica tetrahedra linked together in a zigzag pattern, where one oxygen atom in each tetrahedron is shared with the adjacent tetrahedron. They are similar to ring silicates in that each silica tetrahedron shares two of its oxygen with other silica tetrahedra, having a silicon to oxygen ratio of 1 to 3. Pyroxenes have the general formula XySiAl2O6, where the Y cation is a medium-sized cation in six-fold coordination, and the X cation is either a six-fold or eight-fold cation, depending on whether the crystal structure is orthorhombic or monoclinic. Orthorhombic pyroxenes are called orthopyroxenes, and they have six-fold cations on both their X and Y sites, making them more symmetrical than monoclinic pyroxenes, or clinopyroxenes, which have eightfold cations, typically calcium, on their X site. The orthopyroxene group only has two end members, the iron-rich ferrosilite and magnesium-rich enstatite, with complete solid solution between them. The clinopyroxenes are more diverse and widespread, forming a sizable fraction of most mafic rocks. Like orthopyroxene, there is extensive solid solution among the clinopyroxenes. Some end-member clinopyroxenes are the calcic magnesium-rich diopside and iron-rich heidenbergite, the sodic aluminum-rich jadeite and iron-rich agarine, and the lithium-bearing spodumene. Gemstone-quality jadeite is used as jade, and spodumene is an important ore of lithium. The most abundant pyroxene is augite, which is a calcic pyroxene with an intermediate composition. Double-chain silicates, better known as amphiboles, combine two single chains of tetrahedra by having every other silica tetrahedron share three of its oxygen atoms with the adjacent tetrahedron, forming a ring-like structure. They have a silicon-to-oxygen ratio of 1 to 2.5 and always have extra anions, typically volatiles like hydroxyl, chlorine, and fluorine. Amphiboles can crystallize from a magma, but they usually form during the hydrothermal alteration of pyroxenes via the reaction pyroxene plus quartz plus water yields amphibole. There is an entire class of metamorphic rocks called amphibolite because their mineralogy is dominated by amphiboles. Amphiboles have the general formula Ab2C5SiAl8O22W2 and are sometimes called the garbage can mineral because of their ability to take in so many different elements. The A, B, and C sites are distinguished based on the size of cation they can accommodate, and the W site contains hydroxyl, chlorine, and fluorine. The A site can either be vacant or contain the large cations potassium, sodium, and or calcium. The B site contains medium-large cations such as calcium, sodium, and ferrous iron, and the C site is composed of strips of octahedra that are sandwiched between the chains of tetrahedra, gluing them together. The octahedra are occupied by the medium-sized cations magnesium, iron, and aluminum. Like the pyroxenes, amphiboles are broken down into orthoamphiboles and clinoamphiboles, and of course there is extensive solid solution among their respective end members. Compared to clinoamphiboles, orthoamphiboles are chemically simple, having a vacant A site and only magnesium and iron in the B and C sites. Clinoamphiboles are classified based on the dominant cation in the B site, being either calcium amphiboles, sodium calcium amphiboles, or sodium amphiboles. Blue schist, which is a class of metamorphic rock common in subduction zones, gets its name from the blue color of the sodium amphibole glaucophane, Na2-Mg3-Al2, Si8-O22-OH2. The medium-grade metamorphic rock, amphibolite, typically contains calcium amphiboles, such as hornblende. Sheet silicates, or phyllosilicates, take double-chain silicates one step further. Each silica tetrahedron shares three oxygen atoms with the adjacent tetrahedron, forming an infinite sheet of shared tetrahedra. Sheet silicates have a silicon-to-oxygen ratio of 2-5. The sheet of silica tetrahedra, referred to simply as the tetrahedral, or T, sheet, is stacked on top of an octahedral, or O, sheet, which is a plane of divalent and trivalent cations like iron, magnesium, and aluminum. The T and O sheets stack together to form layers, which are bonded through strong molecular bonds. They can stack in one of two ways. A TO, or open-faced sandwich, configuration, with one T sheet bonded to one O sheet, or a TOT configuration, where a single octahedral sheet is sandwiched by two tetrahedral sheets. The sheet silicates are a diverse group of minerals that include the clay minerals, the micas, the serpentine group, the chlorite group, and talc. The difference between the groups of sheet silicates are the types of bonding that hold together the sheeted layers. For example, in the mineral talc, Mg3-Si2-O5-OH4, they are held together by van der Waals forces, which are relatively weak. It is no coincidence that talc, with a Mohs hardness of 1, is the softest mineral, so soft in fact that it is used to make baby powder. On the other hand, the micas are held together by weak ionic bonds that arise from electrostatic interactions between large interlayer cations, like potassium, and the negatively charged TOT layers. This structure is called TOT plus C, with the C standing for cation. The difference between these two groups is the tetrahedral cations. In talc, only Si4+ occupies the tetrahedral sites, while in the micas, one Si4+ swaps for Al3+, creating a net negative charge among the layers and allowing for stronger electrostatic bonds between the layers, with the large cations acting as the glue. The chlorite minerals have a similar structure with negatively charged layers due to aluminum substitution. However, instead of being glued together by cations, they have an additional positively charged octahedral sheet between layers. This structure is called TOT plus O. The last group has a TO structure, and like talc, the layers are neutral, but in this case held together by stronger hydrogen bonds. It turns out that most of the sheet silicates have a similar hardness, between about 2 and 3, except for the TOT group, which are the softest of all the minerals. The weak bonding between layers gives all the sheet silicates perfect basal cleavage, causing them to peel apart like the plies in a roll of toilet paper. We will now move on to the most abundant subclass of minerals in the Earth's crust, the framework silicates, or tectosilicates. These minerals have a backbone of silica tetrahedra that share all four of their oxygens with neighboring silica tetrahedra. The framework silicates have a silicon-to-oxygen ratio of 1-2, with aluminum often substituting for silicon in the tetrahedral sites, as in the feldspar mineral anorthite, where half its tetrahedral sites are occupied by aluminum. The complete polymerization of tetrahedra creates a complex, rigid structure with large spaces in between, allowing for a wide range of interstitial large cations. The basic chemical formula for feldspars is CaNaK SiAl4O8 and can be separated into three end members: anorthite, CaAl2Si2O8, albite, NaAlSi3O8, and potassium feldspar, KaAlSi3O8. There is complete solid solution between albite and anorthite, with intermediate compositions being called plagioclase. There is also complete solid solution between albite and potassium feldspar, being called alkali feldspar. For two isostructural minerals to have solid solution, their cations must meet one of the two following criteria. One, they have a similar ionic radius, or two, they have the same charge. Since potassium and calcium do not meet these criteria, solid solution does not occur between anorthite and potassium feldspar. Plagioclase is the most abundant mineral in the crust, being a main component of both the continental and oceanic crust. Another important framework silicate is quartz, which is composed entirely of silica tetrahedra, having the formula SiO2. The silicon-oxygen covalent bond is one of the strongest single bonds, making quartz and the other framework silicates very hard. Quartz is actually a polymorph of SiO2, meaning its structure changes with pressure and temperature. Tridymite and cristobalite are the high-temperature polymorphs, with cosite and stishovite being the high-pressure polymorphs. Stishovite can only be formed at pressures greater than 10 gigapascals and is often used to identify ancient asteroid impacts. With that, we conclude our introduction to the silicates and to the classes of minerals in general. But how do these minerals form and come together to produce rocks? Let's move forward and begin to answer precisely this question.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.